So hi, thank you for the time, Laurent, and welcome.
Pleasure.
Welcome. Okay, so can you maybe just introduce yourself shortly and your great winery, and then maybe after the winery, the gin.
Sure. Well, my name is Laurent Haas Aldram, named after my mother, because she is the so-called from the Aldram side. She's the boss, basically. we are family winery. We're based in the Kamptal Valley. We cultivate some 30 hectares here in the Kamptal, mostly terraced vineyards. So about 65% is rather steep and terraced vineyards, so which involves quite a lot of labor intensive or manual intensive work. Also during harvest, everything is hand harvested with us. Regarding the varietal split, we focus on clearly on the white, since the Kamptal sort of is how should I say, most suited probably so far for the whites, with Grüne Veltliner being the most important variety, covering about 60% of our vineyards, followed by Riesling with about 20%, and the remaining 20% basically split up between Pinot Blanc, Chardonnay, Pinot Gris, and Zweigelt, and a little bit of St. Laurent. So that's basically our varietal split. I would say that's a rather usual split for the Kamptal. Most wineries here do not only produce, let's say, Grüner and Riesling. The Kamptal always was known for its sort of diversity also in terms of varieties. And it has a little bit to do also with the geology that you find in the Kamptal. Kamptal has a rather big mix of different soil types and also mesoclimates within the area. And I think that's the reason why a lot of varieties do work, or also would work, probably also varieties that we don't know yet, could work very well here in the area, because we have basically from loess soil, which is very suitable for Grüner, to schist and gneiss soil, to sandstone, but also a lot of sedimental soils from old arms from the old Danube that basically were running through parts of the Kamptal, and those are actually the soils that are very good for the Burgundy varieties Pinot Gris, Pinot Blanc, and Chardonnay. Mm-hmm.
And if you are already talking about soil types, you have a very particular one. I think this Kvöller Gneiss. Can you a little bit explain?
Exactly.
That?
Yeah, I mean, the Kvöller Gneiss basically forms the whole Danube Valley, you can say. So the whole Wachau, the Kremstal, the Kamptal, the mother rock that is sort of underneath the topsoil is always the Kvöller Gneiss, because that's the massif that basically forms all those valleys. Mm-hmm. And it's the leftover of the so-called variscic mountains that in the past were running through basically the whole continent, and they were about almost as high as the Himalaya, and that due to erosion over the past years, basically the Kvöller Gneiss is the very bottom. That's what's left with us.
So the primary rock, and basically, right?
Exactly.
And
exactly.
How deep is it in Kamptal?
How
deep down is it actually? How high is actually the topsoil?
Okay, that really depends. So you find parts where you really have like maybe only a few centimeters and you reach the Kvöller Gneiss. Mm-hmm. And then there's other appellations where you have a very thick layer of loess on top of it, which can be sometimes up to, 6-7 meters deep, And then on some appellations, you have a little bit of schist on top of it, like, for example, on the Geisberg. And then, yeah, and then there's other spots where really you just need to go 30 centimeters of the topsoil, and then you immediately reach the Gfällig Gneiss. So that really varies. So there's no rule that it's always this and that amount.
Okay, perfect. Because I also want to talk about your three Erste Lage or a Premier Cru later, because these are very different, right, in terms of soil composition. But maybe let's get back to the Kamptal, if I may.
Yeah, sure, definitely.
Because you are in Strass, right? In
exactly. Kamptal. Yeah.
So where is it in Kamptal? Is it near the river or?
Yes, basically yes. But everything is near the river in the Kamptal. But Strass basically it used to be actually our own viticultural area known as the Strassertal, which is basically a small side valley of the Kamptal, which goes parallel to the Kamptal towards the north. So it's north south, however you wanna call it. And it's a small side valley that basically lies parallel to the Kamp river. If you look at it geographically on the map, it's basically in the northeast of the Kamptal, looking at it. So we are basically bordering both the Weinviertel and the Wagram area, the Strasse area. And Strasse in total covers about 550, 560 hectares. So it's quite a substantial part of the whole Kamptal with 4,000 hectares. The whole Kamptal, and about 550 is the area of Strass. And I would classify it as a great part of it as a bit of a cooler area, because a lot of cold winds come through the Strassertal valley, which is a bit of a more narrow valley, so the cold air stream is a bit more sort of does not have so much room, like for example where the Kamptal opens up in Langenlois, there's a lot of room for it, whereas the Strassertal, it opens up in the village of Strass, and it's rather narrow. So a great part of our vineyards a little bit later in ripening than other parts of the Kamptal, I would say, and that's why very often we're a little bit higher in acidity, and we tend to pick a little later than other parts of the Kamptal. Of course, there's also other scents of the Kamptal which are equally cold, like for example the area of northern Kamptal. But for example, Langenlois and Gobelsburg, Hadersdorf, Kammern, they're much warmer spots than Strass, for example.
And all your Premier Crus are located in this valley?
No, because the Heiligenstein, for example, which we also cultivate, is part of Töbing, of the village of Töbing, which is basically at the exactly at the exit of the Kamptal, where the Kamptal opens up. That's where you have the Heiligenstein, and also part of our vineyards that are planted on Geisberg, they belong to the village of Töbing. Because the Geisberg is a bit of a special thing, because it doesn't belong to one village only. It belongs to three different villages. So you can a little bit compare it with the Montrachet Hill, which is basically part is Pouligny, the other part is Chazan, and same is with Geisberg. Part belongs to Strass, the other part to Töbing, and another part to Kammern. So no, not all our single vineyards are located in the Strassertal.
And maybe if you want to zoom out a little bit, because maybe not all the listeners are so familiar with these wonderful regions like Wachau, Kremstal and Kamptal. These are maybe the most well-known in Lower Austria. And how would you maybe, like in my personal experience or in, as I know, that Kamptal is always a bit cooler and a bit like, because also the Wartfilter, there is also great forest, right? So also the cold air got sucked, so to say. And also a little bit more north than Kremstal.
Exactly. So on the map, looking from it, from let's say from Vienna, you basically drive along the Danube for about 1 hour. And then you would reach Krems or in Langenlois, this area. And as you just said, the Kamtal of this whole Danube Valley, which is one big pot, basically, the Kamtal is the most northern one. And that's why it is also the probably the one with the coolest climate, which is mostly influenced, as you said, by the northern winds coming from the Waldviertel. And those northern winds, basically, they collide here in this valley situation, because there's not just one valley. There's the Kamp Valley, there's the there's the Krems Valley, and then there's the Wachau. And that's the, and in all those valleys, there's cold air streams, and they collide with the warm Pannonian influence coming from Vienna. And I think, or not, we know that this is what makes our area such a great place also for whites, because especially those sort of day-night changes. So for example, today we had 20 degrees during the day, and at night it's going to cool down to 5-6 degrees, and that's just the best that can happen for the aroma in the grapes. That gives you fresh acidity, and the acidity then in the end is what provides our wines with the aging potential and gives it its longevity, because that's the backbone.
The backbone. That's what I wanted to say as well.
Yeah,
exactly. And so thanks for this introduction, maybe. And then how would you, if you could just give a hint in a blind tasting, how would you say that, because there is also Spitz in Wachau, which is a bit colder, right?
Yes.
So the western part of
Wachau. Spitzergraben.
So how would you maybe like differentiate in terms of wine making or vinification, and also in terms of tasting profile, these wines? These three, beside acidity and cooler aromatics, maybe.
Which three do you mean? Like
Krems, Wachau, and Kamtal.
Yeah, okay. I would say that probably Kamtal is always, or by tendency, I'm generalizing, because also it has to do with the winemaker's style, obviously.
Yeah.
But in general, I would say that Kamtal is always with the probably low alcohol. And sort of more minerality driven style. Most producers, or at least us, work without botrytis, so we do not allow botrytis in our wines. That of course has a big impact on the taste profile, and I would say this is probably how I would still characterize quite a lot of wines from the Wachau, or at least the big names that we know. They do work with botrytis, and that of course changes the taste profile towards this more honeyish, slightly sweeter style, and lower acidity. And the Kamtal, I think, is the opposite, and which is more pronounced acidity, by tendency a little lower in alcohol, and usually no botrytis in the wines. And the Kremstal is somewhere in between, because it really depends if you're looking at the area in Krems, very close to the entrance to the Wachau, so close to Leuven, or the area of Krems, Mautern, Furtwald, or if you're looking into the Krems Valley, Kremstal Valley, going inside to Priel, Senftenberg, this is probably directly comparable with the Kamtal.
Okay. And what where do you actually see this minerality in the wine? So what's your maybe kind of idea where this minerality comes from? Because it's a very controversial topic. And I always ask this from winemakers who talk about minerality. What's your theory, maybe?
Well, my theory is that it obviously comes from the soil. But also you need to adopt your farming and your winemaking to allow it to sort of to shine through in your wines. A Riesling coming, for example, from Geisberg, where we have the so-called mica schist, which is a special type of schist with a high degree of minerality, has a great potential for minerality. However, if you do not sort of adopt the right techniques for the plant to really express its soil, then you won't feel it. But the origin definitely lies in the soil, and then it's your, I think your task as a winemaker to adapt the both work in the vineyard and in the cellar. So meaning allowing a lot of cover crop so that the roots need to dig deep, so that mm-hmm. That you have a highly developed root system reaching a lot of parts of the soil. So this is for me essential. And then also in your winemaking, that you sort of allow contact with the skin before you press it, and then also long contact on the lees, so that you really sort of try to extract all the fruit and all the flavors and tastes that are there. Exactly. Mm-hmm. So that's how I see it. Of course, it's a bit of a how should I say? It's not something, there is no rule or there's no recipe on how minerality how to get minerality in a wine. But I think the most important thing is that you have a proper farming in the vineyards. Then that's the biggest portion of the work. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, but I think it's one of the mysteries of the world, which doesn't have to be
definitely.
And also, a little bit of mystery is good.
and still to us winemakers, sometimes I think it's you get surprised, right? Because everybody would only assume minerality from sort of rocky soils, right?
Yeah.
But very often that's not the case, because the for example, a lot of Grüners from our area coming from less rich soils with high content of chalk in it, yeah. They show extreme minerality. If you pick at the right time, that's also, I think, a very essential thing. If you either pick unripe, so too early, or if you pick overripe, meaning too late, yeah, that you go into this overripeness where you have the botrytis developing, this of course is covering up some of the more subtle taste, mm-hmm. because terroir or the expression of soil is probably in a young vine, in its youth, very hard. You need to be very sensitive and careful in your winemaking to really be able to express this already in a young wine. I think the older wine gets, so with age, I think at the end what's left, if it was a good product from the beginning, is the terroir, because we see that very often, because we produce both Grüner Veltliner and Riesling from Geisberg, and in its youth, very easy for us to say, yeah, this is Riesling Geisberg and this is Grüner Veltliner Geisberg. Mm-hmm. But if you open a bottle that's 20 years old, it's very, very easy for us to say it's a Geisberg, but sometimes very hard to know if it's Grüner or Riesling. Mm-hmm. And this shows us that the taste of terroir is there. You just need to allow it
to be expressed,
express itself also mm-hmm. in its youth.
And why do you think it is? Like Riesling drops a little bit of acidity, or it's going to be more integrated? Mm. Or
yes, exactly. Because the acidity is the one easiest indicator to define if it's a Grüner or a Riesling. But as you said, yeah, you can have a very cold vintage with high acidity levels, so it might be a Grüner as well that had just high acidity, because this primary aromatics from the varietal character, they vanish with age, and terroir sort of comes through.
Mm-hmm. And as you talked about old vines, what's maybe the oldest what you got?
Well, I think the oldest I tasted from our cellar was from the 70s. Because older than that, not much really is left in our cellars. because yeah, my grandfather didn't keep at his very beginnings much wine, and so yeah, from the 70s. And the oldest vineyards that we have, they're about 65 years old Grüne Veltliner wines.
Wow,
those
nice.
Are the oldest that we have. Yeah,
and
the oldest Riesling we have is about 40 years. Yeah.
Wow, nice. And so the oldest ones are also Grüners then.
Yes, in our case, yes.
Yeah. Uh-huh. Okay, and also these are also very ageable then.
Often, yeah, it's crazy. Like very often we get surprises like that. Also wines where you wouldn't expect, you know, like we've always seen or learned, yeah, wine needs to be very rich in alcohol and heavy to be ageable. But so many wines in our cellar from the 80s, 70s, sometimes also 90s that we open, where most of our wines at alcohol levels about 12 and a half, yeah,
mm-hmm.
They are so fresh. You wouldn't believe that it's that age, or that the wines are of such an age. However, they had a great acidity, and I think that's much more important than where we are alcohol. With the alcohol level, and that yeah. That's also why we, for example, we do not pick for sugars anymore. We pick on acidity readings. So when we decide when to pick what, we of course go into vineyard and look at the grape if it's physiologically ripe and if the taste is right. But for me, it's much more important where is the acidity level than where is the sugar level in the grape.
And when it starts really dropping, then you kind of, that's an indication to pick?
Exactly. Mm-hmm. Because for example, as an example, last week we still had 19 per mil, so grams per liter, mm-hmm. Acidity in the Rieslings. This week, just 1 week, we're down to 14. So now it's going fast. Mm-hmm. So next week, again, we will check. And probably next week we will pick the first Rieslings, depending again on the site where it's located, because obviously we have big differences in between the vineyards. But yeah, that's a very important thing for me, the acidity, because we work very oxidative in the winemaking, meaning that we don't work with any sulfur in the grape in the wine production before. Till the moment when we sort of take it off the lease, then we stabilize and sulfur. Mm. But in the whole process, we work very oxidative. So the pH is very important to me in the winemaking. And that's why I want to pick at the right acidity level, because acidity directly sort of influences the pH of your juice and then later wine.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
But now we're getting very technical.
Yeah, please. That's why I wanted to talk to you. And how do you work in the vineyards? Do you work organically or kind of conventionally?
Yeah. No, we work, how should I say? Basically, since 15 years, so since my father is running the vineyards, we're working basically in terms of how we treat our soil. So in the soil management, we work organic.
Mm-hmm.
What we did not do was the organic spraying so far, because my father always used to be a big fan of a way to spray in your vineyards without using copper. As we all know, copper and sulfur are the two very effective sort of still sprayers that are allowed in organic farming, and that's basically what always held my father back from making the last step towards being a certified organic producer, because he said no, because if it's a really tricky year, a very rainy year, I want to have the security to also to sort of rescue my crop. Since I joined now in 15 was the first vintage I worked at home. We sort of experimented also with the organic spraying and doing more and more every year. As you know, 17, 18, 19 were three very warm vintages with not much rain. So actually, it worked very well, also using very low amounts of copper, because it was such dry years with no crazy rain periods. And last year, we basically signed the contract for becoming an organic grower. So we are now in the process of changing to officially being a certified organic producer. But this year was a challenge, I have to say. We had a lot of rain. It worked well, and we are very happy with the results. But it was definitely a challenge. But I think there's a lot. I think there's a lot of a lot will change. In the sector regarding what sprayers will be allowed and not allowed, because I think there's a lot of very good substances like the phosphonates, for example, which were allowed already one time. Then they again said no, they are not allowed anymore. But I think they will again be allowed for organic growers to that we can use them again.
Okay, I'm excited.
For us, it's like for most important thing, and I think for most wine growers is really how they treat the soil, and that you have a healthy soil, because the healthier your soil, the more healthy your plant will be, and the more resist your plant will be against the fungus diseases. So that is the key for in my opinion. And then with the spraying, I think you just need to adapt basically on how the vegetation is and how the vintage is.
Okay. And so maybe 2022 will be your first organic vintage, right?
Exactly, yeah. Exactly.
We already touched upon the vinification, but do you also work with the native yeast mostly, or is it varied?
Yes. Basically, we work with the native yeast from the vineyards. So, meaning that we do not inoculate our wines. Mm-hmm. However, I'm pragmatic. So, if I see that there's a tank does not start fermenting, then the first step that I would do, I would take a bucket of a tank that's fermenting nicely and where I like the aroma profile. And if this does also not work, then I would inoculate. Very frankly speaking, because I think the native yeast, so the fermentation, then the so-called natural fermentation without inoculation, very often it's not the yeast from the vineyard that does the job, but it's one of your yeasts that you have already around, that are already around in your cellar. And I think for me it's more about how the fermentation in general is going, because if you do not inoculate your wines, so if you're not adding yeast, you will have much longer, smoother fermentations, taking much more weeks compared to a classical sort of standard fermentation where you inoculate with yeast. Then most of the time it's done within 1 to 2 weeks, and I'm not a big fan of too fast fermentations, because the ferments tend to become very hot, very warm. You need to cool them down a lot, and it's something that gives stress to the yeast. And I think that this is not the ideal case. The ideal case is to ferment very long and slow ferments. Yeah, we also, as I said, we are not. Our winemaking is very primitive, I always say, because what we do is we take the whole clusters, we press them, then the juice is transferred by gravity to a tank. It settles overnight, and the next day we rake it off, and then to the tank where it should ferment, to the cellar. And that's it. There's not much more to say, because most of our juices that we use for the fermentation, they are not very clean. So we have still a lot of So
particles.
particles in it, exactly. But we also need them since we do not, since we do, we go for natural fermentations. They need more, more sort of stuff to hold on and to get nutrients from.
Okay, and but so you also sometimes work with bigger barrels, right?
Yes, most of, I would say we work basically only with the stainless steel and big wooden casks. There is only one exception, that's our Pinot Gris, the Grauburgunder. For this wine, we use barriques.
Yeah, that's
but all the other wines are fermented in stainless steel or big wooden casks.
That's also one of my safest choice in my pocket if I have to recommend the wine to a guest. That's always a safe choice. That's a very valid wine.
I'm happy to hear.
And also, maybe if we can just now talk about the main differences between these two beautiful sites that you have, maybe in terms of taste and why is it maybe differ?
I would say I'd start with the two Rieslings. One Riesling, as you know, we produce from the vineyard called Heiligenstein, and the other one from Geisberg. Geisberg is our oldest Riesling vineyard that we have. We also have not just one vineyard up on the Geisberg for Riesling. It's a big sort of, it's five individual parts. And great part of the Geisberg also forms our village wine, the Rieslingstrasse, by tendency the younger wines.
Okay.
The soil on Geisberg, which is a mica schist soil, so it's a type of a schist, and underneath you have the so-called Gvöller Gneis. So it's a very porous type of schist, so it's really easy to break apart. Has for me a very high degree of minerality. It is our vineyard which we use for the single vineyard is facing southwest, but probably more west than south. So it has exposure wise, it is not super warm, but gets most of the afternoon sun. The soil on Heiligenstein is this so-called perm, which is named after its earth time. Perm is a period of time. And it's basically a desert sandstone with volcanic components in it. If you look at it and the exposure is south. So our Heiligenstein vineyard is south exposure. And this is all at the end of the day in the wines. Most basically pick at the same time those two vineyards. So we have a slightly higher degree of ripeness there, but also a bit lower acidity due to its more southern exposure, and it's a bit of a warmer appellation compared to our iceberg. And the Heiligenstein, this specific soil, always for me brings such a very unique dark smoky minerality with it. It's basically when you take a lighter, this firestone, when you smell it, slightly burnt stone. This for me is one very typical characteristic of the Heiligenstein, especially if it gets 2-3 years of age, this very clearly comes through. And the Geisberg is always the more, the more classical appearance of Riesling that we would have in mind. So with this stone fruit, vineyard, peaches, apricots, this is more the taste profile of a Geisberg. And then in its age, the Geisberg always gets this beautiful eucalyptus taste, very fresh actually when it ages. And whereas the Heiligenstein becomes very smoky, dark minerality and slight hints of petrol. So this is very different. And this is actually what's so fascinating for us, because those two sites, they are maybe 400 meters apart from each other. but do produce so different wines, even though we work identical both in the vineyard and in the cellar.